إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. So in the previous lessons, we've been discussing the history from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the time of the companions and the time of the Salaf, first century, second century, third century. We've been discussing the development in the writings of the books of Hadith and Aqeedah. And today then, after we've just finished looking at Al-Bukhari and Muslim and the Sunan, the books of Sunan, Abu Dawud and Nasa'i, At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah, we now move on to some other famous books of Hadith also. سبق القول بأن القرن الثالث الهجري يعد العصر الذهبي لتدوين العلوم الإسلامية عامة وعلوم السنة النبوية خاصة. We've already mentioned that the third century Hijri, it is considered as the golden era for writings. The third century is considered as the golden era for the writings, Islamic writings as a whole, and specifically the writings in relation to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وتابع علماء السنة في القرن الرابع من سبقهم في خدمة السنة المطهرة. That is something which then continued into the fourth century also. In the fourth century, the scholars continued the work of the scholars of the previous centuries in their writings and in their efforts in aiding the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فكان منهم من نسج على منوال الصحيحين في تخريج الأحاديث الصحيحة. And there were some in the fourth century who tread upon the pathway of al-Imam al-Bukhari and al-Imam Muslim in attempting to put together books with only sahih Hadith in them. So you have examples like the Sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah and the Sahih of Ibn Hibban and the Sahih of Ibn Sakan and the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ نَهَجَ مَنْهَجْ أَصْحَابِ السُّنَنِ فَالْاِقْتِصَارِ عَلَىٰ أَحَدِيثِ السُّنَنِ وَالْأَحْكَامِ مع اشتمالها على الصحيح وغيره. And there were other scholars who put together their books and their writings more upon the pathway of the style and the method of the books of the Sunan, of Sunan Abi Dawud and Ibn Majah, Tirmidhi and Nasa'i. There were some scholars who put together books more like those types of books in the fourth century. You have examples like the Muntaqa of Ibn al-Jarud and the Sunan of Ad-Darqutni and the Sunan of Al-Bayhaqi, even though Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi is a little bit later in his death. He died in 458 Hijri. But it can be associated to the 4th century. His works are often connected in with the 4th century, even though he himself died in 458 Hijri. فَهُوَ مُتَأَخِّرْ وَفَاتًا لَكِنْ يُمْكِنْ عَدُّهُ في القرن الرابع تجوزا لتقارب كتب السنن. وكذلك نجد من اعتنى في هذا القرن بالتأليف في مختلف الحديث ومشكله، كما في كتابي الطحاوي شرح معاني الآثار ومشكل الآثار. Also in the 4th century there were books written about explaining hadith and what might look like contradictions in hadith. How do we understand them? How do we harmonize them? There were books of that nature that were also written. You have the two famous ones, Sharh Ma'ani al-Athar and also Mushkil al-Athar of al-Imam al-Tahawi. وذلك تتميما وتكميلا لما بدأه الإمام الشافعي. And that was in completion of what al-Imam al-Shafi'i had already begun في كتابه اختلاف الحديث. A book by al-Imam al-Shafi'i, اختلاف الحديث, talking about the different narrations and what may look like contradictions in narrations. والحافظ ابن قتيبة في كتابه تأويل مختلف الحديث وغيرهما مما ألف في ذلك النوع في القرن الثالث. And also that example of ابن قتيبة. So these were books that were written in explaining narrations and how to combine them and what may look like contradictions in them, or explaining complicated and difficult sections of narrations and words. Similarly, كما ظهر لأول مرة نوعان من المصنفات في هذا القرن. There were two new types of books that emerged in the 4th century too. Two new types of books that emerged in the 4th century. وهذا يعد من التجديد في مجال خدمة السنة. وهذه ميزة أخرى لأهل السنة، وهي أنهم في كل عصر يعملون تفكيرهم ويبذلون جهدهم في ابتكار طرق ووسائل جديدة لخدمة سنة المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم. So two new types of books, new categories of books came about and emerged in the 4th century. And this is considered as a distinguishing factor of Ahlus Sunnah. That they don't just sit back on what's there and that's it, but that they will produce works that will aid the Sunnah in different ways, from different perspectives, from different angles. So they will write books that aid and help you understand the Sunnah from different perspectives. So two new perspectives, two new angles emerged in the 4th century, which had not been done particularly in this specific style before. It existed, the knowledge existed. It's not like it was brand new knowledge that nobody knew before. It existed, but it didn't exist in this specific style of authorship. One of them is Kutub al-Mustalah, Ulum al-Hadith, the books that talk about the sciences of Hadith. Sciences of Hadith, we mean by that the various understandings of how you grade a hadith, for example, a sahih hadith, a weak hadith, hasan li ghayrihi, hasan li dhatihi, what we were talking about last time, something which is hasan in of itself, something which is hasan because of supporting evidences, talking about narrations where a narrator has the same name as another narrator, but they are two different people. How that can sometimes be confused and how you work it out. All types of issues on the sciences of hadith, on the sciences of the chains of narration. These types of specific books came about in the 4th century. فكتب المصطلح علوم الحديث التي جمعت أو جمعت تلك القواعد التي كانت متفرقة في كتب من سبقهم من علماء القرنين الثاني والثالث. So like we said, the sciences of hadith, that knowledge, those sciences were known in the earlier centuries, of course, and they were written down too, but just not in a fashion or in a method organized as it was and specifically done as it was in the 4th century. So previously there are examples of books written about the sciences of hadith. The famous example they mention is Ar-Risala of Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i. Within that there is discussion regarding the sciences of hadith. Similarly, the introduction of Sahih Muslim. In the introduction of Sahih Muslim, he mentions the sciences of hadith within it. Ar-Risala li-Shafi'i wa muqaddimat Sahih Muslim wa kitabihi At-Tamyiz. Al-Imam Muslim has another book known as At-Tamyiz. And that is a book also that discusses the sciences of hadith. Wa kutub ma'rifat ar-rijal wal-'ilal. And the books regarding the narrators and the problems or hidden defects within narrations. All of those types of books and that science, it existed. But it was properly organized and put together into specific authorships into the 4th century. وَيُعَدْ الْمُحَدِّثِ الفاصل لأبي محمد الرام هرمزي أول مؤلف في ذلك. The first book, or the book that is considered as the first book in the sciences of hadith, properly put together as a book in the sciences of hadith, is the book known as المحدث الفاصل by Abu Muhammad Ar-Ram Hurmuzi, who died in 360 Hijri. ثُمَّ تَبِعَهُ أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ Al-Hakim. Then you have Abu Abdullah Al-Hakim, who died in 405 Hijri, with his book مَعْرِفَةُ عُلُومِ الْحَدِيثِ, also specifically organized about the sciences of hadith. And then there were others that followed thereafter. There is the second type of book that emerged in this century too now. And the second type of book that emerged in the 4th century are books that are known as the Mustakhrajat. Books that are known as the Mustakhrajat. But those will come to them in a proper chapter soon. وهناك أنواع أخرى من المصنفات في مجال تدوين السنة في هذا القرن مثل معاجم الطبراني والعلل للدارقطني الذي رتبه على مسانيد الصحابة وغيرها. And there are other books that were written in this time too, famous books in relation to the Sunnah, in the sciences, and in aiding the understanding of hadith and authenticity, etc. There are the books known as the Ma'ajim al-Tabarani, Mu'ajim al-Tabarani. And he has those. And there is the Ilal of al-Darqutni. So there are other famous books that were written at that time too. Amma fil qarn al-Khamis al-Hijri. As for the 5th century Hijri, faqad salaka ulama'u sunnah طُرُقًا أُخْرَى وَمَجَالَاتٍ جَدِيدَةٍ لِتَدْوِينِ السُنَّةِ وَحِفْظِهَا وَجَمْعِهَا حَيْثُ ظَهَرَتْ فِي هَذَا الْقَرْنِ النُّوَاهُ الْأُولَى لِلْمَوْسُوعَاتِ الْحَدِيثَةِ. In the 5th century, again, the scholars renewed their efforts in aiding and supporting the Sunnah from different angles. And so another new type or new types of books emerged in the 5th century. And what emerged in the 5th century, the beginnings of it, were the books that you could mention are like encyclopedias of hadith. We had before Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, books of hadith. In the 5th century, huge encyclopedias of books combining many ahadith into them emerged. Encyclopedias of hadith. So for example, there were books written in the 5th century that combined the hadith of Al-Bukhari and Muslim into books. Al-Jam' bayna sahihayn. There were books that combined between the ahadith of all 6 of those books that we spoke about, Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and then the Sunan of Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nisa'i, Ibn Majah. Combined the ahadith, Al-Jam' bayna sitta. And all of these types of books, we will speak about them briefly in their independent chapters coming up, insha'Allah ta'ala. So, coming back to the 4th century for the moment, in the 4th century, we mentioned that there were some scholars who wrote books upon the same style of As-Sahihayn. Books that included within them authentic narrations. Well, that was the attempt. One of them, an example, a famous one, is the Sahih of Al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah. Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. And Ibn Khuzaymah, he is Abu Bakr Muhammad Ibn Ishaq Ibn Khuzaymah An-Naysaburi. Abu Bakr Muhammad Ibn Ishaq Ibn Khuzaymah An-Naysaburi. And he has many books, in fact. Ibn Khuzaymah wrote many books. He was born in the year 223 Hijri. Born in the year 223 Hijri. And died in the year 311 Hijri. Born in 223. So to put that into context, he was born in 223. When did Al-Bukhari die? 256. He, Ibn Khuzaymah, was born in 223. Al-Bukhari died in 256. Al-Imam Muslim died in 261. So you can see Al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah was born during the lifetime of those other scholars of the 3rd century. He was born during their lifetime, and then he died in 311 Hijri. 311 Hijri. His book is famously known as the Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. And ذكر الدكتور محمد مصطفى الأعظمي محقق الجزء الموجود من ابن خزيمة أن اسمه كما وضعه مؤلفه مختصر المختصر من المسند الصحيح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنه مختصر من كتابه المسند الصحيح. This book of Al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah, the section that we have available to us and which has been checked and verified and printed, the person who checked that book, Dr. Muhammad Mustafa Al-A'zami, he mentioned that Al-Imam Ibn Khuzaymah actually gave the title to his book as Mukhtasar al-Mukhtasar min al-Musnad al-Sahih, that it is the summary of the summary from the Musnad al-Sahih from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that this book was actually, therefore, a summary of his book, Al-Musnad al-Sahih. وقال الحافظ ابن حجر وسمى ابن خزيمة كتابه المسند الصحيح المتصل بنقل العدل عن العدل مِنْ غَيْرِ قَطْعٍ فِي السَّنَدْ وَلَا جَرْحٍ فِي النَّقَلَةِ. There is a title mentioned by Ibn Hajar that Ibn Khuzaymah said it was called المسند الصحيح المتصل, the connected musnad, connected chains of narration, بنقل العدل عن العدل, via the narrations of an authentic narrator from another authentic narrator, من غير قطع في السند, without any cuts in the chain of narration, without any breakages, ولا جرح في النقلة, and without any disparagement in the narrators. All of that as the title of his book. Al-Imam Ibn Hajar mentioned this was a title Ibn Khuzaymah had stated too. But of course, as we said, it is famously known as Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah. شرطه في كتابه. What was the condition that he stipulated in his book? How would he select which hadith to put in there or not? اشترط ابن خزيمة رحمه الله في هذا الكتاب ألا يخرج إلا الحديث الصحيح. He of course put it down as a condition that he would not report within it except authentic hadith. وقد نص على ذلك في عنوان كتابه حيث قال مختصر المختصر من المسند الصحيح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we know that because in the very title of the book he had said it is the summary of the Musnad as-Sahih. So the very fact that he called his book the Sahih indicates that he put it down as a condition he was only going to report the Sahih narrations therein. How did Ibn Khuzaymah organize his book? How did he put it together? How did he write it? What was his manhaj in writing the book? His manhaj in the book, meaning the style of how he put it together, how he organized it, that's his manhaj in the book. So what was his manhaj in writing this book, in putting it together? 4 points you can say. Firstly, رتبه على الكتب والأبواب فبدأه بكتاب الوضوء ثم كتاب الصلاة وهكذا. صحيح ابن خزيمة is organized upon chapters. So he begins, for example, with the chapter of wudu and then the chapter of prayer and so on. Organized in chapters one after the next. ثم يورد تحت كل كتاب مجموعة من الأبواب. And under each, in fact, what we should say is, not chapter after chapter, but book after book. That is the better way. The book of wudu, and then the book of prayer, and the book of X, Y, and Z. And then all of those books were put together into the overall book, Sahih ibn Khuzaymah. Because remember, when the scholars wrote their books in the past, what we now just call chapters, it would actually be a bit more complicated. They would have the books within their overall book, and then each book had chapters. So it's like several books, each one with chapters in it, that are all put together to make this final Sahih ibn Khuzaymah. So he had several books, and under each book, he had chapters. So the book of prayer, and then under the book of prayer, you have the chapter of Adhan, the chapter of Jum'ah, the chapter of Eid, the chapters of the different topics about prayer. So he had the books, and then under those books, he had the chapters. And then he would mention, of course, all of the ahadith, etc. under those. يورد الأحاديث مسندة منه إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَإِذَا كَانَ لِلْحَدِيثِ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ طَرِيقٍ يَذْكُرُهَا. He then would mention the ahadith connected in the chain from himself up to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when he was narrating a hadith, he would say, and I narrate this hadith from his sheikh, who narrated it from his sheikh, from his sheikh, from the Prophet ﷺ, connected to him. So he was writing those ahadith with those chains of narration connected through him, from him to the Prophet ﷺ. And if a particular hadith had more than one chain of narration going to it, he would mention those other chains of narration also. يعقب على الحديث غالبا بالكلام على سنده ومتنه. Often what you find in Sahih ibn Khuzaymah is that at the end of the hadith, he will annotate or comment on that hadith. So he will mention commentary regarding the chain of narration of that hadith if there's things to be mentioned about it. He'll give some commentary on the actual wording of the hadith and if there's things to point out regarding it. وَيَعْتَنِي بِضَبْطِ الْأَلْفَاظِ. And he also paid attention to making sure that the words of the hadith were properly highlighted in their correct pronunciation, how to pronounce everything properly. وَمُخَالَفَتْ كُلِّ رَاوٍ الْآخَرِ فِي لَفْظِهِ. And he would highlight where different narrators gave different words of that hadith. Where they gave different wordings, he would highlight these wordings of the narrators. وَغَالِبًا مَا يَبْدَأُ كَلَامَهُ بِقَوْلِهِ قَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ. And often when he's going to add some commentary, he would begin by saying, قَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ. Abu Bakr says, or said, and then the commentary. Abu Bakr is, of course, himself. كَثِيرًا مَا يَذْكُرُ الرَّاجِحُ عِنْدَهُ فِي الْمَسْأَلَةِ فِي تَرَاجُمِ الْأَبْوَابِ عَلَى طَرِيقَةِ فُقَهَاءِ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ كَالْبُخَارِ وَأَبِي دَاوُدَ وَغَيْرِهِمَا. Often, he will mention his opinion, what he believes to be the strongest position in a given issue. An issue comes up, he comments on it, and he will give what he feels is the strongest position on that particular point. And that is often done in the titles that he gives as well of the chapters. And that's exactly how Al-Imam Al-Bukhari would do it, how Al-Imam Abi Dawood did it. So he similarly gives those positions of his of what he feels is the strongest position in the chapter heading. How in the chapter heading? Meaning what he believes to be the strongest position, that's what he'll title the chapter as. In the chapter title, he will indicate what he believes to be the strongest position. So that is a brief background. What is the status of Ibn Khuzaymah as a book? How strong is it as a book? Where does it fit in? قال الحافظ ابن الصلاح ثم إن الزيادة في الصحيح على ما في الصحيحين يتلقاها طالبها مما اشتمل عليه أحد المصنفات المعتمدة ويكفي كونه موجودا في كتب من اشترط منهم الصحيح فيما جمعه ككتاب ابن خزيمة. He said that additional authentic narrations on top of what is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, if a student searches for them, you'll find them. Al-Bukhari and Muslim didn't put every sahih hadith in there. There are more sahih hadith which aren't in Bukhari or Muslim. Of course, there are more. Bukhari and Muslim doesn't mean every single sahih hadith there is in Bukhari and Muslim. There are others too. So if you search for them, you will find them in other books, he says. Other authentic narrations, sahih narrations, which aren't in Bukhari and Muslim. And he gives an example of one of those books where you could do that, the sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah. So there are authentic narrations in Ibn Khuzaymah, sahih hadith, which are not in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, extras. وَقَالَ الْحَافِظُ الصَّيُوطِي صَحِيحُ ابْنُ خُزَيْمَةَ صَحِيحُ ابْنُ خُزَيْمَةَ أَعْلَى مَرْتَبَةَ مِنْ صَحِيحِ ابْنِ حِبَّانِ شِدَّةِ تَحَرِّيهِ حَيْثُ إِنَّهُ يَتَوَقَّفُ فِي التَّصْحِيحِ لِأَدْنَى كَلَامٍ فِي الْإِسْنَادِ فيقول مثلا باب كراهة كذا إن صح الخبر أو إن ثبت كذا. الإمام السيوطي, الحافظ السيوطي, he says that the Sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah, it is a higher level than the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, which was another book very similar to this from the same century. That the Sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah is considered higher level than the Sahih of Ibn Hibban. Because Ibn Khuzaymah was very precise and very careful. To the extent that sometimes, even for the slightest issue, then he wouldn't just stamp it as Sahih. For the slightest issue, he would then comment and say X, Y, and Z if this hadith is Sahih. Just because there's a slight issue in there. So he would be very precise and very careful with his authentication of narrations. Even the slightest issue in there, then he would comment and say, if this hadith is Sahih, then X, Y, and Z. So he is recognized as being higher level than Sahih Ibn Hibban. الإمام الذهبي said, وقد كان هذا الإمام جهبذا بصيرا بالرجال ثم ذكر عنه أنه قال لست أحتج بشهر ابن حوشب ولا بحريز ابن عثمان ولا بعبد الله ابن عمر ولا ببقية ولا بمقاتل ابن حيان ثم سمى خلقا من الرواة الذين حصل في الاحتجاج بروايتهم خلاف بين الأئمة مما يدل على شدة تحري ابن خزيمة وتوقيه في الرواية في الصحيحة رحمه الله. الإمام الذهبي said that الإمام ابن خزيمة was somebody with insight into the narrators. He had knowledge and insight into the narrators. And that Al-Imam ibn Khuzayma mentioned, I don't take the narrations of Shahr ibn Hawshab, etc., the names that we listed. And so he, Ibn Khuzayma, highlighted a list of people, a list of narrators where there was a bit of a difference over whether they are okay or not. And all of this analysis and listing people, and I don't take from him and him, all of that indicates how serious Ibn Khuzayma was in ensuring authenticity and being precise with things. What efforts have the scholars put into Sahih Ibn Khuzayma thereafter? Just like we spoke about Al-Bukhari and Muslim, how the scholars put effort into those books afterwards. Have the scholars done works on Sahih Ibn Khuzayma too? اعتنى العلماء بصحيح ابن خزيمة رواية وإسماعا ونسخا وممن اعتنى به من المتأخرين. So yes, of course, the scholars did give importance to this book, صحيح ابن خزيمة, and they did work on it. And from amongst those who did work on it, from the later scholars, one of them is الحافظ سراج الدين عمر بن علي, famously known as ابن الملقن. Died in 804 Hijri. Died in 804 Hijri. He did a summary of a book known as Tahdhib al-Kamal by Al-Mizzi. مَعَ التَّذْيِيلِ عَلَيْهِ بِرِجَالْ سِتَّةِ كُتُبْ. Tahdhib al-Kamal is a book that speaks about the narrators from the six books. Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. Tahdhib al-Kamal, which is a summary from Al-Kamal, that all speaks about the narrators from those six books. Ibn al-Mulaqtan did a summary of that book, but then added on biographies of narrators from six more other books. And they were the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad, the Sahih of Ibn Khuzayma, the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim, the Sunan of Ad-Darqutni, and the Sunan al-Kubra of al-Bayhaqi. And that book is known as Ikmal Tahdhib al-Kamal, the completion of Tahdhib al-Kamal. So that is somewhere where Sahih ibn Khuzaymah entered into. Wal-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, who died in 852 Hijri, حيث صنف كتاب إتحاف المهرة بالفوائد المبتكرة من أطراف العشرة وهي موطأ الإمام مالك مسند الشافعي مسند الإمام أحمد سنن أبا الدارمي صحيح ابن خزيمة المنتقى أبو ابن الجارود we mentioned earlier صحيح ابن حبان المستخرج of أبو عوانة المستدرك of الحاكم the شرح معاني الآثار of الطحاوي and the Sunan of الدارقطني. Those 10 books put together into a book by Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar regarding the chains and the narrators etc. So Ibn Khuzaymah's book was in that too. قال الحافظ وإنما زاد العدد واحدا لأن صحيح ابن خزيمة لم يوجد منه سوى قدر ربعه. What you will have noted there is that we mentioned the Muwatta of Imam Malik, we mentioned the Musnad of Shafi'i, we mentioned the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, the Sunan of Ad-Darimi, the Sahih ibn Khuzaymah, the Muntaqa of Ibn al-Jarud, the Sahih ibn Hibban, the Mustakhraj of Abu Awana, the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim, the Sharh Ma'ani Al-Athar of Al-Tahawi, and the Sunan of Ad-Darqutni. How many is that? Six? You only counted six books? Nine? MashaAllah, nobody? GCSE maths, nothing? 11! I was counting my fingers too. How much more help do you need? 11 books they were there. 11 books. However, the title of Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, his book is Ithaf al-Mahra bil-Fawaid al-Mutakra min Atraf al-Ashara. 10! But there's actually 11. How come then? Because Sahih ibn Khuzaymah, the whole book, we don't have it. All we have available, what is known, is mentioned there as a quarter of it. Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar said it's only a quarter of it. So that's why he didn't really count that as one full book and made it 11 altogether. So that gives you a brief background on the Sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah. The next chapter begins on the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, but inshallah ta'ala we'll begin that as a separate lecture by itself. The Sahih of Ibn Hibban, inshallah ta'ala, the next time. Up to there, that gives you a background on the Sahih of Ibn Khuzaymah. So we'll round off on that for today then. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ